nobody here this morning. Did we show up for church on the wrong day of the week?
No, silly. Don't you know all Sunday services and midweek events here and in all churches are canceled, just like schools, concerts, sports, and other public gatherings until the pandemic is over?
Oh, I get it now, of course. What was I thinking? But you still haven't told me who you're talking to.
I'm talking to you, Zach.
No, I mean, why did you say good morning, kids, and good morning, everybody, when nobody's here? Church is so empty, I can hear my own echo.
Well, it's because we're recording church for all the people to watch from their own homes, while we're all social isolating and can't do church together here.
Recording church?
Sure, Zach. Can't you see the camera right in front of you?
Wow, that makes me a celebrity.
No, you're just the same old crusty Zach, except that now you're wearing the mask.
If you keep talking to me that way, Molly, I'm never going to give you my autograph.
Zach, don't let it get to your head.
What do you mean? Is that any way to talk to a TV star?
Zach, be careful you don't get addicted to all the attention. Remember, when you're always in the spotlight, it blinds you.
I'm no dummy. Hey, say, catch. Can you catch? Good one. I've been busy buying up shares in toilet paper ever since the virus struck, but now I can see I got something better to do with my time. Molly, it's showtime!
Zach, we're not here for entertainment. We're here to worship and bring glory to God.
Molly, get a life. You're way too serious.
Zach, it's been a long time now since the people have seen or heard from us. The world has really changed since everything's gone into lockdown. In these dark times when everyone's feeling down and stressed about the COVID-19 pandemic, and nobody knows what the future will bring, you and I are here to give them hope and encouragement.
Really? That sounds important. Then what do you think I should tell everybody? Stay the blaze at home?
No, Zach, that's not it. We've got something infinitely better to share.
What's that?
It's the good news that even though times are tough, God is with us and He'll bring us safely through the storm.
Wow, that's wonderful. But Molly, how can we know for sure with so much bad stuff going on all around the world?
It's because God never breaks His promises.
Never?
No, never. Give a listen now to Jesus' promise to us from John chapter 16, verse 33. I have said this to you, that in me you may have peace. In a world you will have tribulation, but take heart. I have overcome the world.
That gives me goosebumps and makes me feel all warm inside.
That's great, Zach. The word tribulation means pressure, stress, and trouble. Jesus doesn't promise to make everything easy for us, but He does promise to be with us and conquer everything that comes against us, because He loves us and wants only what's very best for our lives.
Wow, that's good news, and I want to tell everybody so they don't have to be afraid.
That's what it's all about, Zach.
Happy Mother's Day, everybody. I get it now, Molly. Jesus makes us all one family. So you and I and all the people listening from home are sisters and brothers, just with different mothers, but we all have the same Father, our Father in heaven.
You said it, Zach. Thanks, everyone, for tuning in this morning.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Thank you. Good morning and happy Mother's Day to all you mothers, grandmothers, and great-grandmothers. It's wonderful to have each of you tuning in with us this morning. Our thanks to Valerie Malice for sharing the hymns that we are enjoying this morning in worship. Hear then God's word. From 1 Peter, the second chapter begins at verse 4. Come to him, to that living stone, rejected by some, but in God's sight chosen and precious. And like living stones, be yourselves built into a spiritual house, to be a holy priesthood, to offer spiritual sacrifices acceptable to God through Jesus Christ. For it stands written in Scripture, Behold, I am laying in Zion a stone, a cornerstone chosen and precious, and he who believes in him will not be put to shame. To you, therefore, who believe, he is precious, but for those who do not believe, the very stone which the builders rejected has become the head of the corner, and a stone that will make men stumble, a rock that will make them fall. For they stumble because they disobey the word, as they were destined to do. But you are a chosen race, a royal priesthood, a holy nation, God's own people, that you may declare the wonderful deeds of him who called you out of darkness into his own marvelous light. Once you were no people, but now you are God's people. Once you had not received mercy, but now you have received mercy. The end of the lesson. The Holy Gospel for this fifth Sunday after Easter is from John, the 14th chapter, begins at verse 1, the words of our Lord Jesus. Do not let your hearts be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. For in my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again to receive you to myself, that where I am, you may be also. And you know the way where I'm going. Thomas said, Lord, we don't know where you're going, so how can we know the way? Jesus said, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. If you had known me, you would have known my Father also. Henceforth, you know him and have seen him. Philip said to him, Lord, show us the Father, and we shall be satisfied. Jesus said to him, Have I been with you so long, and yet you do not know me, Philip? He who has seen me has seen the Father. How then can you say, Show us the Father? Do you not believe that I am in the Father, and that the Father is in me? The words that I say to you, I do not speak on my own authority, but the Father who dwells in me does his works. Believe me that I am in the Father and the Father is in me, or else believe me for the sake of the works themselves. Truly, truly, I say to you, he who believes in me will also do the works that I do, and greater works than these will he do, because I go to the Father. Whatever you ask in my name, I will do, that the Father may be glorified in the Son. And if you ask anything in my name, I will do it. This is the gospel of our Lord. This morning's gospel lesson has been shared at countless funeral services, and it's one I've read and recited at hundreds of funerals myself. Comforting though it is, this gospel text is just too great to reserve only for funeral and memorial services. Jesus begins, Don't let your hearts be troubled. The turmoil he speaks of here describes literally the churning, angry, agitated water of a stormy sea. Well, that's exactly what we're facing now as we weather the COVID-19 storm together. In these troubled, turbulent times, Jesus' words speak with as much power as the first day spoken to his disciples. Whatever the storms we face, we don't need to be afraid and overwhelmed, because Jesus says, You believe in God, my Father, believe and trust also in me. Jesus has everything under control. He has a plan, and he promises that in our Father's house there are many rooms, room enough in heaven for everyone who wants to be there. We've all seen paintings of the heavenly banquet table depicting the sumptuous and lavish dinner we'll enjoy in the glory of heaven with our Lord and with all who look forward to celebrating it with him one day. The table stretches far off into eternity, into infinity, as a way of reminding us and making the point there's room in heaven for everyone who wants to be there. Jesus told his disciples he would soon go ahead of them to prepare that place for them and for all who love and follow him. But Jesus the carpenter didn't mean that he was going to do a house reno, the likes of which is popularized on so many television programs today. No, he would prepare that glorious, everlasting home in heaven for us all, made possible by virtue of his death and resurrection. That's how Jesus makes it ready. But Thomas protested, "Lord, we don't have a clue where you're going, so how can we know the way?" Jesus answered with one of his seven great I am sayings, "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." Do you remember the other I am sayings? "I am the bread of life. I am the light of the world. I am the door. I am the good shepherd. I am the resurrection and the life. I am the true vine." And now in answer to Thomas's question, "I am the way, the truth, and the life." All this is easily lost on us, but the words "I am" are really a loaded term, because out of the Old Testament we learn that this term "I am" is in fact the very name for God himself. Do you remember when the Lord called Moses from the burning bush? "Moses, I want you to go to the mighty Pharaoh, the king of Egypt, and tell him, 'Let my people go.'" But Moses protested, "But Lord, I don't even know your name. So when he asks me who sent me, what am I going to say?" And the Lord answered, "I am who I am. Just tell the mighty Pharaoh, I am has sent you." That's how the name God translates. So Jesus is revealing here his divine nature. He's God come to us in human flesh. "I am everything you need." Philip spoke up, "Jesus, please show us God the Father and then we'll be satisfied." But Jesus said, "Whoever has seen me has seen the Father." And I love the way Martin Luther expressed it so very beautifully in the words of a large catechism. Jesus is the mirror of the Father's heart. Jesus is the mirror of the Father's heart. So if we want to know and understand God's true nature and character, all we have to do is look at Jesus, the one who taught and counseled, healed and forgave. For he is God himself who walked and lived among us and is the clearest revelation of the Father's love. So Jesus reveals here his true identity. "I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me." We looked at Jesus the life last Sunday, and we'll leave Jesus the truth for another time. But this morning we're considering Jesus who is the way, the only way. And it's noteworthy that so many of the world's great religious systems share the same language. Hinduism speaks about the threefold way of salvation, the way of works, the way of knowledge, and the way of devotion. Ancient Chinese religion is called Taoism. It means a way, a road or a path. It teaches about the way to go. Japanese religion is called Shintoism. It translates as the way of the higher spirits or gods. And the Japanese have given us Judo, the way of defense, and kendo, the way of swordsmanship. Buddhism teaches the middle way between two extremes, asceticism or self-denial on the one hand, and of self-indulgence on the other. That's where the rock band gets its name. Nirvana, this middle way, it claims to lead to heaven and enlightenment. And in the book of Acts, we discover that the earliest designation for the Christian faith, this fledgling sect, the followers of Jesus, were called followers of the way. Jesus said, "I am the way." Religion presumes to show us the way to God, to heaven, and to salvation. It's all about do's and don'ts, human performance, striving and sweating harder and harder to earn the Supreme Being's love and acceptance. But Jesus stands alone from all the religious leaders of the world because he didn't simply claim to show us the way. He said, "I am the way to life, to heaven and salvation." Then it's not a principle, not a practice, not a precept, or a philosophy, or a prescription, but a living person. Alice in Wonderland was confused and asked about which way she should go. The Cheshire Cat answered, "Well, that depends a good deal on where you want to get to." Alice explained, "Well, I really don't care." And so the cat advised her, "Then it doesn't really matter which way you go." There's a popular notion that there are many ways, so it doesn't really matter which way we choose because all of them lead to the same destination. All roads lead to Rome. But I've been to Rome and I've discovered that all roads do not lead to Rome. Many roads will take us to an entirely different place. Some believe so long as you're sincere, it doesn't matter which way or path you take. But truth be told, we can be sincere and yet sincerely wrong. Some say it's arrogant and narrow-minded to presume that Jesus is the only way. Just who does he think he is anyway? The deep space atomic clock is an amazing new technology now being introduced on GPS satellites. It's revolutionizing space navigation to Mars and to other far long distance destinations. In order for NASA to locate spacecraft with precision and with a very small margin of error, astronomers need clocks that can measure millionths of a second. The deep space atomic clock is so accurate it takes 10 million years to gain or lose a single second. It's a breakthrough in space technology that staggers the imagination. But it's that kind of accuracy that's absolutely essential so the trajectory is true and reliable so spacecraft can land safely and reach the intended target. Precision is everything. And that's the way it is in the kingdom of God. Wandering aimlessly will never get us home safe and sound. Jesus is the only way. Many times over the years when I've been driving out in the country or perhaps in the big city on holidays or making pastoral visits, although absolutely certain that I was on the right road, I discovered I was on the wrong road. Once I even drove the wrong way on a one-way street. It was frightening to be driving the wrong direction, so I turned around in a hurry. God's word warns us about the danger of traveling the wrong way. There's a way that seems right to a person, but the end of it is the way to death. All we like sheep have gone astray, we have turned everyone to his own way. How many people are cruising the road of life, but blissfully unaware they're heading in the wrong direction, on a collision course with destruction? The sports world is replete with stories of football players who got disoriented and ran the wrong way, carrying the ball into their own end zone. What an embarrassment. It's the ultimate mistake that could cost the team the game. The great Christian writer C.S. Lewis told about how excited he was as a teenager on his first day arriving at the prestigious Oxford University to begin his course of studies. Carrying his bags, he walked from the train station to the college, straining his eyes for his first glimpse of the fabled spires and towers of Oxford that he'd heard so much about and dreamt about for so very long. But as he walked toward the open country with no sign of the university in sight, he eventually turned around to discover the majestic spires were behind him. He had been walking in the wrong direction. And some years later, after he surrendered his life to Jesus, Lewis looked back on that experience as a kind of an allegory and parable of his early life as a committed atheist, traveling in the wrong direction, away from God, instead of toward him. He'd been in rebellion against the one who loved him most of all. When I was a little boy in grade school, I remember a story in our reader from Greek mythology about a youth named Icarus. A master craftsman named Daedalus ingeniously and skillfully designed for young Icarus a set of wings created from feathers held together with wax. Imagine how excited Icarus was as he prepared to fly for the very first time. But Icarus was warned to be careful and not fly too close to the sun, because if he did, the wax would melt and the feather wings would fall apart. But Icarus was so intoxicated with his newfound ability to fly that he ignored the warning and began to soar higher and higher. As he flew closer and closer to the sun, sure enough, the wax began to melt, and he crashed into the sea and drowned. As the scriptures tell us, pride goes before a fall. And when I first heard this short story, I thought it was just an amusing tale, but since those days, I've learned it has a powerful lesson for us all about the folly of pride and vanity, of reaching too far, overconfident or misguided ambition, poor judgment, and of what can happen when we don't listen to the voice of reason and wise counsel, but are determined to strike it out on our own in the wrong direction. And so we're wise to listen to the voice of God, God the Holy Spirit, as His Word teaches us. This is the way, walk in it. Robert Frost, the celebrated American poet, wrote a short piece called The Road Not Taken. It ends as follows. Two roads diverged in a wood and I took the one less traveled by, and that has made all the difference. You see, there are only two paths, two ways, two roads, as the scriptures teach us. One of these ways is broad and easy, well-worn and well-traveled. It's the path of least resistance. It's so attractive and so inviting, but it's a dead end. The other way is narrow, hard, and challenging. It's Jesus' way. Sooner or later, we all find ourselves at the fork in the road, at the crossroads of life, where we must make a decision. And there's so much at stake, so much weighing on the decision we make and the road we take. Which way, which path are you taking? Jesus says, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father but by me. Thank you. the gift of family. And for our mothers, those living and those passed on from this world, for their many sacrifices, their love and inspiration. We especially thank you for mothers who have introduced us to you and modeled for us the life of faith, those who've taught us to pray, have first brought us to your house and guided us in our journey of discipleship as we follow you along our pilgrim journey here on earth. Help us always to keep your word by rising up to honor and call them blessed, not only on Mother's Day, but all the days of our lives. Bless and encourage all mothers with the assurance that theirs is a high and special calling from you, and inspire us all to be examples of faith, active, and love, that we might also guide others to your Son, Jesus. Strengthen, preserve, and restore all families. Turn the hearts of the parents to their children, and the hearts of the children to their parents. We continue to pray for the containment and defeat of the COVID-19 pandemic. Give wisdom to government leaders, healthcare specialists, and to all as we look forward to a time of relaxing isolation measures with caution and care. We pray for good and favorable seeding weather for all farmers and for all who work the land, knowing that you alone can make the crops in our own gardens grow, and it's from your gracious hand we receive every good gift. Guide our steps along the path of life that you have set before us, for we ask these things in the name of Jesus, who is the way, the truth, and the life, the one who has taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Receive this blessing. Now remember this God who is with you always. He goes before you to show you the way, behind you to encourage you, beside you to be your friend, above you to watch over and protect you, and within you to fill you with love and peace and uncontainable joy.